Hello. Hi there. Have we met? I'm Josh. Nice to meet you. Look at all these pillars I've got. I'm never gonna run out of pillars. Don't worry. You don't need to worry about me. Don't bring pillars on Thanksgiving. I've got plenty. Here's what I want to do. I've got, you know, I made these pillars a while ago, and I had cut these ones at the same time that I cut these ones, but I just got around to painting them on last time we met. You remember the last time we met, right? And you know, these ones are just too monochromatic. Like, there is a little bit of brown in them, but more or less they're like very black and white. So I'm trying to push the color just a little bit more. I put more, essentially this is what I did. I pre-mixed my base gray, some with brown, some with yellow, green, red and blue, right? And so these are my sort of accent colors. And I'm trying to develop the technique where I can dry brush over these colors with a lighter version of the color as opposed to a light gray, because what I'm finding, you can see it pretty well right here, is that the light gray is, it's not that it's muting the whole color, because that wouldn't necessarily bother me. It's specifically that just the raised highlight areas are gray. Now, if I used just white as my highlight color, that would be solved. But using just white does not give you a realistic look. If you're going for a very stylized look, it's fine. But I'm going for trying to be realistic. So white's not gonna cut it. So my thought was, so basically I went in and I recolored over most everything and took away most of my dry brushing, essentially. So I'm down to like the flat colors. And now I'm going to try to reintroduce my dry brushing now with colors, so colored dry brushing. And rather than mixing them with a lighter gray, I'm just gonna mix these toned down colors with white and see where I end up. Look at that. I just sequestered another pillar. Congrats to me. I've also been doing these toilet paper and paper towel roll pillars that are going to be in other parts of the same big old diorama. So I've been saving these up as they come available. Upscaling, baby. No, up. Upcycling, that's the word I was looking for. Who finally showed up, Garthor? Moi? Am I the one you've been waiting for all this time? Okay, so. Believe it or not, that is sort of a blue-gray, as opposed to gray-gray. Now, if this technique doesn't work, then what I'm probably gonna do is go to the pure colors mixed with white. Let's see what that does for me. I don't know, we'll find out. Brown gray, yellowish greenish gray, and red gray. Said I went live like 20 minutes ago. Well, yeah, I mean, so Reaper makes me do this thing where I I go live and then I sit at a screen forever, which apparently is best practice. Like, you know, whenever you go to a game stream or whatever, they do that. I never bother to do that on my own channel. Like, why be coy? If you're streaming, you're streaming. But apparently, that's not the way you're supposed to do it. So I do it right when I'm doing it for Reaper. Let's see. What's the best way to mix these, do you suppose? How about this? Let's try this. Portion out our white. That does. It's not getting white as quickly as I thought it would. Yeah, I don't know, maybe it builds anticipation, gives people time to stream in, spread word of mouth, they'll be like all over the internets being, oh my god, you guys, Josh Foreman's about to stream on Reaper, quick, join us, you got 15 minutes. I don't know how it works, I don't make the rules. So that is a significantly lighter bluish gray. Lighter brownish gray. Greenish gray. I feel like I had a more yellow before. I think I did. I probably had a yellow and a green, and at some point my yellow got used up. That's what I'm thinking. And we'll see if this amount of added lightness is enough. Might not be. In particular, I'm worried about, as it tends to go towards pink. And maybe that's right. You know, maybe reddish rocks that have worn edges get pinker at those worn spots. I should look up some reference to make myself more comfortable with this. More white. I don't know. We'll see. So this has some brown. I'm trying to see how, yeah, it's very subtle and it might be too subtle. What I'm thinking is that the highlight, the dry brushing here is actually going to unsubtleize it. Which then will be resubtleized by the wash. There's also areas where I just kind of dab the various colors around and let them intermix, you know, with a really wet mix. So I'm free to go in and sort of dry brush the different colors on where I feel in my heart. You know what? Fine, Garth Thor. Fine. You're right. More white. When you're white, you're white. You know, I'm not actually sure that there should be more white in all the colors, but I'm making an educated guess here. That's my middle name, Josh Educated Guess Foreman. Music I use for my book commercial. It makes me happy. When in doubt, add more paint. Yeah, especially when it comes to baking. That's just a general rule. These cookies need more salt or butter? Neither. They just need more paint. To tell what I've done for red and what I've done for brown. They're very similar. It can't hurt to just do a little bit of both. It is, after all, just dry brushing. Reminds me, I keep meaning to get a water cup. I keep forgetting. You know what? I have water here and a cup here. And now I have a water cup. Viola. this is definitely making me feel a lot better about dry brushing, getting those colors actually, the highlights actually matching what they're going over. Makes a big difference. That's why if you're doing like just black and white, you never have to worry about that. It's just grays, different shades of gray, but once you start introducing colors, it's a whole new ball game. Again, my dry brushing philosophy is to be pretty light-handed with it. I am not of the dry brushing school of go over everything. You'll get a very stylized look that way, but again, not a realistic one. Especially if you make those noises while you do it. Very stylized. That's true. If you're frustrated about something, do a stylized dry brushing. Pretty sure that's what they say. That's what most therapists recommend. Try to actually break up that highlight line so that it's not just one like contiguous line of white, but there's areas where it fades out completely and other areas where it's a little bit stronger. In fact, I can just go in and like pop in even a lighter light spot here and there to bring that effect out even more. Nine out of 10 dentists. When have they ever got 10 dentists in the same place? I've always heard 4 out of 5. I think dentists are kind of like Highlanders. There can be only one that disagrees. That's how they're like Highlanders. Oh, right, brushing. Yeah, dentists are into brushing. I've never had one recommend dry brushing to me. That sounds uncomfortable. Any greens in this one? I don't think I do. Can't hurt to do some greenish, dry brushy highlights here and there. This is supposed to be red, actually. And I'm wondering if my brown is still too light, as in not light enough. You know, when you say too light and you mean not light enough, that thing. I'm just gonna continue to plow on, find my blues, don't get distracted. Stay on target. This middle one looks like I did another mix. Looks like I've got some blue, brown, several different things going on. Try to keep the highlight colors to what appear to be the base colors to the best of my ability. And then we'll see. I'm really hoping that when I do the wash over this, it doesn't just like completely eradicate all of this nuance that I'm spending time on here, but I would not be surprised either. This bluish tinted highlight seems like it's actually sort of agnostic enough where I can use it on the regular less blue gray as well. Because the gray that I mixed up just by happenstance of the particular paints that I used is kind of more of a cool gray than it is a warm gray. Which is why it's pretty hard to actually pick out the difference between the blue tinted one and just the regular gray. one of the things that's kind of nagging at the back of my mind is that the big, you know, diorama that these are all going in, it's not like fully designed yet. So a lot of these elements, I'm going to be kind of finding a place for them and sort of building the walls and the shelves or walkways, whatever you want to call them, that go up the walls to the size of these pillars that I've created. And so once they're all sort of situated in place, they're going to, like, the whole thing around them is going to have to be painted, obviously, and I'm going to want to make sure that I use similar techniques and colors and all that kind of stuff. But, you know, I mixed up a finite amount of this paint, and so no matter what, there's probably going to run out and have to improvise a bit, I suppose. And that's probably fine. You know, when you look at reference of ruins, they're quite often patchy and unmatching parts all over the place. But there's something, you know, in my artist designer brain that's like, it just feels so wrong. Part of the issue there is that there's always a reason that those random patches are the way they are, you know, having to do with the structure being cannibalized by locals to be used for other things, or, you know, the quarry that they were building the thing ran out, or that particular color and property of rock ran out, and so it has to be supplemented with other things. And depending on the order of operations for the construction of the place, it could be random. Like, you could imagine if they were building these out of separate blocks, right? Rocks from a nearby quarry, which is 90% of the time the case. And one of the veins that had a particular highly concentrated olivine in the rock, giving it that green hue, that vein just peters out, and then you have a lot less green. Well, depending on which part of the structure they're building, it's going to sort of stop having green in it. And that's okay. Environmental storytelling. At least that's what I'm going to tell myself. Some of the one that had less white mixed in to start out, and then I'll build up to that lighter one. was that red? Well, I'm gonna say it's a little bit of both. And use a little bit of both, because why not? Sometimes at different angles, the colors read as slightly different, making them somewhat elusive to identify. So I'm looking over the colors that I did, like this brown. I think the dry brush that I did a fine job of like subtly bringing out the textures. However, could use a lot more than that. So I'm going to do another white boost. And I'm not saying that I should have done more white at the beginning. In fact, I think what I did was about right. It's just a matter of now going through and doing a much more light touch, brighter highlight. Definitely seeing some good color range in there. Still trying to decide if I want to pop the highlights a little bit more. I think that what I'm leaning towards is rather doing my wash and then after the wash coming in with the final sort of agnostically very light gray, almost white dry brush, just of the very select bits and pieces where it makes sense. Let's see how that turns out. I got wash over here. These are a mix of black and brown ink with some Flow Aid, maybe dish detergent, you know, just a drop or two, and water. This will probably make a good little catch dish. Have a nice, like, long, thinnish one to pull the drops down, and a thicker one to move the body around. Let's practice it on this one, since this is a back part of the thing you're not going to see, so it's a good place to practice. Actually stir this. Doesn't seem to be have as much of the pigment mixed in there as I would hope. Has been sitting around for a while. Definitely a layer of gunk on the bottom there. Where the pigment has precipitated out of the mix. You see, worm? I'm making a giant diorama. About the size of a bathroom. Walls, ceiling, floor. It's a backdrop for a giant sculpture that I made of a Colossus. From the game Shadow of the Colossus, this is one of his hands. So you can get a sense for the size. It's a pretty big sculpture. Something this big, I'm just gonna go to a giant brush. House brush, if your house is a face, then yes. I believe this is a makeup brush. I got a, you know, just really cheap set of it, of makeup application brushes on Amazon. And they've come in pretty useful. Do I not have another paper towel roll in here? I think I don't. One sec. Behind a lot of these sort of grimy patches. That's the, oh yeah, forgot. Now that I have this little shelf here, I'm able to have all my reference on hand. There we go, okay. And so the actual walls and stuff, you can see, here's the general look. Very aged, blurry, grimy rocks. Let's see if I have a better. Oh, here's the updated Shadow of the Colossus that came out, I don't know, 2018 or something on PS4. So they up-resed all the graphics. And, you know, it's still the same general aesthetic, but. So that's what I'm kind of going for here. Thing goes, attaches to this tower, which is another big part of the diorama. And it's gonna go like right. So I wanna make sure that it more or less matches what I've already concocted over there. Shredder's Revenge. Oh yeah, that one, is it six player, I think I saw? I'm pretty sure I have a spray bottle with this stuff too, but I don't wanna break that out and start spraying all over since I only have 20 minutes left. Is it pretty much like the TMNT arcade game, like just a side-scrolling beat 'em up? I think I saw like an ad, like a still shot ad of it. That's as much as I know. your kids ever played a side scroller beat 'em up? It is not a common genre these days. Yeah, that's not very close to, I mean, it's side-scrolling, but not very beat-em-up-y. I think the last one I played was Castle Crasher. No, wait, there's like an indie game, what was it called? It's like a mashup of an RPG and a side scroller. Very story driven. Or was it turn based? Might be turn based RPG. Side scroller. I think that's what it was. It was very interesting. Came out a year or so ago. The most notable thing about it is there's this crazy bad guy character that's named Heather that also looks like if Heather was evil and lived on the streets, as in my wife Heather. See, that's the colors are still definitely showing through at this point. Like, you can tell there's a big difference between that and that. You know, less so between that and that, but it's still, you know, it's still subtly in there. And then if I want to get a more sort of directed stain, I can start pushing some drops down. So given that a lot of these are sort of, how to put it, the less hero version of these ones that I did earlier, where I spent a lot more time on getting like nice, ruiny cracks and stuff. On these, I kind of want to decide, okay, what's the front? And just focus on that so I'm not wasting my time doing a bunch of fastidious little drippy drip work on something that's going to be facing a wall. Although sometimes the drips are so good that they'll overpower the geometry underneath and be like, you know what? This is the side because it's got the best drips. In this case, obviously, I put a little bit more work into this side, so yeah, this is clearly the front. Like, these two sides right here, don't care about these back parts. In the words of that one rap song from the 80s or 90s, I don't care about big butts and I cannot lie. You other brothers can't deny. When a pillar comes in with an itty bitty waist and a plain back, I don't care about the plain back. I'm pretty sure that's how that song goes. I'm doing my best to remember it. It's been a while since I've heard it.
Daddy?
Yep.
So they said to come in on schedule time. So at 2, but she was like, you know, like he doesn't seem to be running too far behind.
As in, so I could drop you off a little before 2 and get back here by 2:30 if we left, like, at exactly 1:30.
John literally just got in the shower to take me.
Okay.
So my thought is, he's probably running behind. So if you're leaving at 3:30, I mean, you're probably going to get there at 4. So I don't know that if I should have John just wait in case, or, you know.
You could do that. Play it by ear, I guess. Just let me know. And if you do end up, if he does end up waiting, then maybe you guys could stop by the office and grab my stuff for me.
My only thing is I'm not feeling super.
Oh, okay.
Amazing. It might be.
So I'm going to have to drive into the office anyway, right? So if he.
Yeah, I just mean, like, if it gets, like, if Erickson's actually on time, then I'm going to be waiting, like, an extra hour for you. That's assuming if you even can get there by 4.
Right.
So, but I mean, it's Erickson, so probably not. But it's also not a long visit, right?
Yeah.
So I'm not quite sure what the right thing to do is. Because right now it's 17 minutes to get there.
Mm-hmm. Well, I'm sure John wouldn't mind not going, despite having showered.
Well, yeah, but you think, can't miss your playtest.
I know, but if I drive you in at
you will not have enough
1:30.
Time. Playtest starts at 2:30.
Right. You said it takes 17 minutes.
Oh, you
to get
mean
there?
Take me there and come back?
Right. Come back for you after. Or John can go to pick you up instead of dropping you off, right?
Oh. Except, do you know how much work it takes to get him to remind him to get going? So
fair.
I think what I could do is just see if he wants to wait for a little bit. And if I get, if they're not taking me back by 2:30,
mm-hmm.
or before 2:30,
then just call him and let him know.
Yeah. Like, I'll let him know if,
there's also the emergency backup of just, like, getting a whatever.
Yeah, but I don't even have
which you've never used before.
And they don't have to wear a mask. And if they won't wear a mask, and you say, okay, well, I don't want that ride, then they'll still tell you, so.
Wow. Yeah. You can't request up front?
Yeah.
Wow.
Only when it's about a virus. Then no one actually has
Yeah, it definitely has a basement smell to it. I can't really place it. Highlights by doing this because I haven't taken the time to spray a clear coat over it. Wait for that to dry. I may do that for the rest of these since we're just about at time anyway. Although when I dab the wash, I'm still seeing those highlights, so maybe it's working all right. Some of these drip buildups here, which take away from the realism aspect, because you can see that's clearly, you know, a real world size drip, not a miniature size drip. So I always take a pass as it's drying over it to make sure those aren't building up in knotty places. Oops. What's the best side? I like these textures. I like this texture. Not a huge fan of that one. That's like clearly a foam tear line. It has some visual interest, but see, this is my favorite face. And this is my least favorite face. And this is my least favorite. So my favorite faces are away from each other. I guess I'll go with this. I guess. Dripping down my arm. All right, we're at time. Let's go find someone cool to do the old raid to, as the kids say. The old raid. I have been Josh Foreman. I do art and stuff like this. I've got a YouTube channel, an Instagram, a Twitter, a Facebook. I write books, I publish books. They're on Amazon, they're called The Scarred King. Look them up if you like fantasy adventure and lots of illustrations and cool old maps and stuff. I bid ye adieu. See you guys all later. Thanks for hanging.
Y'all.